What's up, everyone? Today we'll be talking about one of the biggest ever operations against botnets specifically. It's called Operation Endgame, and here's the pilot for it from Europol. That video was created by Europol and is basically their version of an introduction to Operation Endgame. Europol, which is a law enforcement agency, for those of you not familiar with it, that stands for European Union Agency for Law Enforcement Cooperation. It was established in 1998 and basically unites like 90 or something like that, law enforcement agencies in the EU to try to combat crime as one. The Europol headquarters itself hosts around 257 liaison officers from all different countries and agencies. In 2021, Europol had about 1,400 people that actually worked for the organization. So typically, Europol serves as a central hub for various law enforcement agencies that are coordinating some pretty serious operations against things like organized crime and terrorism. And of course, the former would be like the Darknet markets that we tend to talk about so much on this channel. In our little corner of the Darknet, which is Darknet markets, we typically hear about them when they do things like a takedown operation on a darknet market. In the threat actor realm, though, you hear about them when they get owned by black hat hackers like Intel Broker, which is a whole different video that I'll be dropping at some other point. There's a lot more that goes into this. It's one of the first times that I've seen a dedicated site that Europol has made basically on a clearnet just to try to grab info. They've made dedicated sites before, like after Operation Spector and a couple other operations just to kind of rub it in. But this one was fairly interesting and a little bit diverse compared to what they usually do. So they have a dedicated site for this, and it basically just says, reach out to us. The site is called operation-endgame.com, and comes complete with a countdown timer and all these different episodes of videos. Basically, the first episode, which is S1E01, Green Horse, arguably the S1 stands for season one and 01 part stands for the episode number. Operation Endgame, which Europol released another short video on titled Connection Lost, is labeled as the second episode in season one. The video was not all that descriptive in many words. Like, Operation Endgame basically was a massive international effort to disrupt botnet droppers like IcedID, SystemBC, Pikabot, Smokeloader, and Bumblebee. And typically with these kind of law enforcement busts, we see like really cheesy videos, or like we see like really cheesy sites. But this one, they actually didn't do too bad with the videography, I would say. I do have to say I kind of like the production quality of these videos. They're kind of cyberpunkish. If you go to OperationEndgame.com, I'm not telling you to do that, so let's make that clear. You'll also see a message by Europol that says this: "Welcome to the Endgame. International law enforcement and partners have joined forces. We have been investigating you and your criminal undertakings for a long time, and we will not stop here. This is season one of Operation Endgame. Stay tuned. It will sure be exciting, maybe not for everyone, though. Some results can be found here. Others will come to you in different and unexpected ways. Feel free to get in touch. You might need us. Surely, we could both benefit from an open-hearted dialogue. You would not be the first one, nor will you be the last. Think about your slash our, basically, next move." It's kind of cheesy for my preferences. Like, in my opinion, it's a very copish way of saying be scared and reach out to us, and that you can snitch both on yourself and on others. And I'll tell you why. It reminds me of this method that when I was a kid, back in the 90s, I had heard about law enforcement using this method to combat cable theft. So for those of you that aren't 100 years old, in the 90s, you had cable boxes, and you had cable black boxes, which were devices that basically let you get all the channels for free. They would announce on these channels that whoever was watching the video or the specific channel won X amount of dollars, and to call them at this 800 number on a pay-per-view channel, or like another type of premium channel, maybe HBO or something like that. And like many people did. And when they did, their numbers and their names were cross-referenced with current cable subscribers. And in turn, the people who had no subscription or a subscription that didn't include those channels were charged and fined for stealing cable. Now, I do have to say, the last video that they have out at the time of the creation of this video is called Who is Odd? And it's basically Europol saying that they don't know who this person named Odd is, and he's apparently responsible for some malware, and they ask for assistance.
This is Odd. And these are different nicknames he used during the past few years. Odd was responsible for Imhotet. Imhotet was taken down by law enforcement. He wanted to return, but got taken down quite fast again. Who knows what Odd is doing right now? What nicknames does he use? Who is he working with? What is his current product? Who is Odd? Please get in touch with us and let us know.
So what's been the actual fallout from all of this? Operation Endgame ended up leading to the arrest of four individuals and the worldwide takedown, if you will, of like 100 servers worldwide. Earlier, I had mentioned various droppers, and this probably requires some clarification for those of you who don't know what a dropper is offhand. What's a dropper? Droppers are a type of malicious software, and they're designed to install other malware onto a target system. They sneak past security and deploy a number of programs like ransomware or spyware. Like, droppers themselves don't usually cause direct damage, but they're definitely very important for doing things like getting other harmful software onto the system. Basically, droppers open the door for the nasty stuff. Pretty much what I already said. IcedID, also known as Pikabot, started off as a banking Trojan that stole financial data. But like any good piece of malicious software, it evolved and now helps with all sorts of cybercrimes. SystemBC is another nasty one. It facilitates anonymous communication between infected systems and command and control servers. Pikabot was a Trojan that provided initial access to infected systems, which then paves the way for ransomware deployments and remote takeovers and data theft. Smokeloader is used to download and install additional malware onto the infected system, which is kind of the definition of a dropper. And there's Bumblebee, which is typically spread through phishing campaigns or compromised websites, and it enables the delivery and execution of further malicious payloads. Now, this operation, from my understanding, wasn't like a one-country affair, and that's kind of obvious just by the fact that Europol did it, but it was massively coordinated actions that basically led to four arrests so far, one in Armenia and three in Ukraine. Europol and other agencies conducted searches in 16 locations across Armenia, like the Netherlands, Portugal, and Ukraine. Over 100 servers were taken down or disrupted in countries like Bulgaria, Canada, Germany, Lithuania, the Netherlands, Romania, Switzerland, and the United Kingdom, the United States, and Ukraine. In total, over 2,000 domains fell under law enforcement control. Interestingly, one prime suspect allegedly made something like $69 million in cryptocurrency by renting out criminal infrastructure for ransomware deployments. It said that many of the authorities in these countries are actually keeping a close eye on these transactions and have already secured legal permission to seize various assets when the time actually comes to do so. So how do droppers actually work? They first infiltrate a system, which can happen through a bunch of different ways, like email attachments, compromised websites, or even bundled with like legit software. Once they're in, the dropper installs additional malware onto the victim's computer, usually without that person ever noticing. When droppers are really clever about avoiding things like detection, because that's what they're built for, they might do things like obfuscate their code or run in memory without saving to disk, or impersonate legitimate software processes. After deploying the additional malware, the dropper might go inactive or even delete itself to avoid detection, leaving the payload to carry out its malicious activities. Operation Endgame, apparently, from what they say, is far from over just because these actions have already been carried out. In curiosity about what happens at the end of the timer, I wrote them and asked, and I still haven't gotten a response by the time it came time to actually make this video. Europol claims that this is a ongoing effort to stem all this, and that there will be new actions announced, and suspects who haven't been arrested yet are still on the radar, according to them. And Europol's website for Operation Endgame will provide information for suspects and witnesses to reach out. Now, to me, if I were criminally involved in something like this, I would probably take this time to completely clean house and destroy anything that might be used as evidence in the future. Europol played a pretty important role in the execution of all this. They facilitated the information exchange and provided analytical support. Over 20 law enforcement officers from various countries were at Europol's headquarters to support the coordination of the actions, according to the press release that Europol put out. And hundreds of officers were involved in the field operations, according to them. Virtual command posts were set up for real-time communication and coordination during the operations, thus making sure that everyone was on the same page, again, according to the data that Europol has put out. National authorities from the EU member states like Denmark, France, Germany, and the Netherlands, and non-EU states like the USA were all key players, apparently. Agencies like the FBI, Secret Service, and local police forces were also, apparently, according to Europol, instrumental in making this operation a success. That said, an agency that, like, I've never seen Europol come out and say, oh, the FBI had a minor role in something like this. They always seem to say that all these different agencies were instrumental or key to success, which is, and it's kind of funny. I guess everyone's the key to success. It's like participation trophies. I'm not a fan of malware or any crimes really that have actual victims. Like, I've always went hard for darknet markets, mainly because I think that they do like way more good in terms of harm reduction. That said, like, ransomware and botnets, in my opinion, are generally used in negative ways. Europol's consistent hunt of darknet markets makes me not cheer for them when they win victories like this. But by default, I do see the takedown of these seven or so botnets as a good thing. Like, not just for everyone who's actually a victim of them, but for the community, both on the clearnet and on the darknet. And I've had a few friends of mine say that they think that the speeds of Tor have actually improved because of this as well. I really haven't seen that, but I'm not sure about it. So, like, let me know in the comments if you've seen any of these improvements or you think it's nonsense. What's your opinion on all of these four arrests and the videos that they put out and all that kind of stuff? It would definitely be interesting to see what the next thing that happens is. As of the making of this video, the timer on the website says 4 days left. So I definitely look forward to seeing what happens after those 4 days. How many more? I mean, they pointed out season one, which kind of tells us there's going to be multiple seasons, I would think. Either that or they're just idiots. Like, it would make no sense to say season one if there's only going to be one season, right? It's like, if there's one version of a movie, they don't put a one after it. It's only when there's a second or a third that it might be labeled as such in any other given place. In any case, thank you for watching to the end. It's been great having you, and I will see you in the next video.